the attack other... levels of us being victims is soaring out of control, balance.
I've processed the numbers, ran them through many algorithms, and I've come to the conclusion that there needs to be a different solution.
Andrew, we got to talk about this.
For sure we do, man. It's a hard thing to talk about, but let's do it.
And actually, it's like sort of a never-ending story. We talked about this in LA. We're talking about it again in New York, but with, I guess, different incidents to sort of highlight it. An 89-year-old woman in Bensonhurst, Brooklyn, was attacked as she was going for a nightly walk in broad daylight, though it was still light outside, and she was kind of slapped around and then set on fire.
Police say this horrible assault happened 10 days ago. Now, we spoke to a witness who says she was just walking by when she saw her elderly neighbor assaulted, and she wonders who would do such a thing and why.
Lucky enough, thank God, she was able to escape it with very minor injuries. She was able to, you know, put out the fire that was set on her back with kerosene oil. But basically, it sparked a anti-Asian racism rally. And it's the first of its kind. I've never seen anything like it before. Kudos to the rally and kudos to the rally organizers. Somebody just had to do something because a lot of Asians get picked on. And I wrote a crazy Instagram post about this like a few months ago.
Right.
It's still relevant to this day. It's been relevant for 10 years. It's been relevant for 20 years. It's been relevant for 100 years. Yeah. Asians in the Western society more often than not maybe get picked on, and getting picked on looks different in different settings. But right now, the ones that are being highlighted are more visceral, more physical, more like terrible incidents,
more extreme versions. Yeah, this is clearly not the first time, and it probably won't be the last time. I mean, I wish I could say that, to be honest. I wish I could say, yo, no other Asian grandmother is going to get picked on for no reason, and I'm just like, it might happen again.
It's messed up because it's not even a news story. It's a news story to us, but it's not even making the national news. Basically, what I see right now at this moment, August 2020, I see more people reaching their threshold of being sick of it.
Yeah.
For the longest time, I don't think you could talk to any intelligent Asian American and have them deny that this is the truth. We are talking about getting alpha'd in physical direct confrontations constantly in Western society.
Yeah.
This, nobody would ever debate you on the existence of this dynamic.
Exactly.
Find me someone who would debate this.
I mean, there are so many personal stories that everybody has about this, but they just process it differently.
And I think that the rallies are really important because some people would be like, oh, well, what's a rally going to do? Blah, blah, blah. Well, first of all, a rally sort of is a signal to the rest of society that, yes, we are willing to self-organize around essentially this cause. People really tend to rally when they're sick of something. It's been happening, it's been happening, it's been happening. So, by the way, I don't think rallying is the only thing we need to do. But I do think it is important because if you look at the history of America and Western society, specifically, you know, democracies like America, protests and rallies have been effective in changing or having at least a substantial impact on the narrative of the country.
I mean, this is coming off the heels of the Black Lives Matter protests, you know. So, of course, I think that the idea of protesting is kind of like, yo, everybody knows it can do something now. So, yeah, you should use it. And for so long, Asians wanted to keep it on the inside and be like, nah, we can handle this. Or like, nah, it happens, but it's not that bad. Or like, oh, this thing happened. I don't want to say it. But now they're just like, you know what? I just got to get out in the streets.
Yeah, hold up for a sign. Sure. For sure. And I think for the longest time, Asians have just been viewed as like this ultra quiet, ultra docile, keep your head down, want to be invisible group. And I just think that, like you said, people who are very consumed with playing the game to come up and have a certain game plan, speaking out on behalf of the people who are the most vulnerable and susceptible to getting picked on every single day, every single situation, it's like, could throw off their game plan. Is that selfish? It is, right? To be honest, I would say so. Yeah. I know some people have been getting called out lately. You guys, we keep it real and we try to keep it pretty balanced.
It's
for
selfish.
People who make millions of dollars off Asian representation, to not speak out on behalf of the vulnerable people is selfish. Yeah. Not evil, but it's self-centered because you're worried about throwing a wrench in your game plan that you're running to get your goals.
Yeah.
And it is true that in Asian society, even traditionally or else the way our story played out in Western societies, caring about the lower end. Do you think it's not something that people need to take into consideration?
Let's just say the powerful people up top, they're a little bit more okay in being like, hey, you're standing up for your people. Okay, I respect that. I'm not going to like think that that's a bad thing anymore.
Right. And obviously, because so many high profile African Americans that don't need to speak out for themselves and their extended family because they're all taken care of, they're still doing it on behalf of everybody else. I agree that a lot of Asian celebs and a lot of Asian like media representation people play it too safe. Mm-hmm. They play it safe to the point where it's almost like overly conservative. Everybody's trying to run a certain philosophy, but you're right. I actually think society gives Asians more leeway than Asians even think to speak out on behalf of the people who are more broken and people who are getting more attacked.
I think a lot of people were looking at Asians for so long and being kind of like, why don't you guys speak up more? Like, if you're mad about this stuff, why don't you go do something?
So, kudos to China Mac. Kudos to everybody else who, you know, was pushing that rally. Because I do think that those rallies are something that is, like, needed. I'm not... It's one piece of the puzzle.
Exactly.
But it's actually a new piece that probably wouldn't have been introduced into the mix had some people not stood up and been like, yo, let's do this. Do I think that everybody takes the anti-Asian racism rallies fully seriously from other groups? No, I don't think so.
Yeah. Black people have been rallying for decades. And Asians, if we're just kind of starting to rally for ourselves, for our own very, you know, micro issues, and we're just starting that now, it is going to take some time for other people to take it seriously.
Kudos to everybody involved that's getting the ball rolling, at least on that specific puzzle piece. But there's a lot of other puzzle pieces, and those are the other puzzle pieces we need to discuss.
So what are the other puzzle pieces, for example?
Basically, the other puzzle pieces are that Asians probably need to be more politically active and vote more.
Listen, I know that especially this election, for example, you might not like the options that you have on the table, but at least you got to vote locally. And that's something that I would really push for people to do, is that if you can vote locally, that's actually going to affect the police more. It's going to affect everything more, your own representative. That affects your life quicker and more directly than even voting for the president. So
basically, yeah, we do have to become more politically active. We do have to show up for rallies, and we do have to have like more leadership, because it's just this weird situation, because it's true, Andrew, if it's only like people with money or with a lot of education or a lot of shrewdness are able to protect themselves, who's going to protect the people who don't have money and don't have connections or don't fully know how to move, or maybe they're just stuck in one place?
A lot of the educated Asians that got the know-how, they don't always bring that thinking down to less powerful Asians and help organize them.
Yeah, there's not a necessarily sharing of knowledge, resources, or connections.
They don't come down. Once a lot of Asians make it, they move out. And by that, I mean physically out of the neighborhood or the hood or the enclave. And then also they're just like disconnected. They're like, nah, man, like, I just hope you guys can come up like me. You know, and I understand that thinking too, but like you said earlier, it's selfish, and how the poor Asians or the lower income Asians get treated still affects how the richer, more powerful Asians get treated too.
Yeah.
It's all connected.
Yeah. Right. But I think a lot of people are more looking maybe at their own micro individual situation but they're not thinking about the macro, because the macro is really difficult to take care of.
That would never happen to my grandma. She wouldn't be out by herself. That won't happen to me, my kid, because my kid will know what to do, or my kid won't be in that neighborhood or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, and this is like that kind of thinking. It's like, yeah, that's like partially true.
No, I do think on the flip side, specifically Cantonese people. Yeah. I'm going to say it.
The grandmother was Cantonese.
Grandmother's Cantonese. The guy who got picked on with the cans was Cantonese. Not every incident has been Cantonese, but a very, very sizable amount.
Probably
over half.
The largest
slice.
That is the largest single group.
Yeah. Of people that have experienced, like, I guess, like the harshest physical racism from coronavirus. And if you guys know anything about the Cantonese American experience, statistically, anecdotally, historically, factually, a lot of Cantonese people tend to live in the hood. It happens in Seattle, Beacon Hill. Not everybody on Beacon Hill is poor. I mean, there's definitely poor people. There's definitely some people with a lot of money, but everybody just lives on Beacon Hill.
Yeah. In New York City, Asians are the poorest minority group. A lot of people don't know that. In New York City. And that means a lot of them are Chinese.
Right.
Not all of them are Cantonese, but a lot of them are Chinese. Because it is true. So Chinese happen to be the ones who get picked on a lot. Bullied, robbed, whatever, hurt.
Well, all Asians get picked on, by the way, but probably you would say Chinese would get picked on the most. And sometimes even on Instagram, I always see people comment, yo, man, why are Chinese like OD get, they're the, like, the dweebiest.
Yeah. Other Asians say that.
Yeah. Other Asian, Chinese. Other Asian groups say that.
Yeah. So
other Asian cultures tend to have one of two things, either a stronger, deeper warrior culture built into the everyday society, or more recent war, which also can contribute to, everybody's getting.
Well, that hardens them and gets them ready for
Chinese action. Chinese both traditionally do not have very deep warrior culture. It's more of a scholar, imperial court culture.
And farmer.
Kind of like anti-warrior, to be honest. They don't, their wars were like a long time ago.
Right.
So people are not really like still amped up from that time, like on guard. So,
that's just why.
Just to give you guys some like deeper insight,
But I guess like, is the answer that we be more warrior-like? Can we just all of a sudden flip the switch? You know, do the Drake, flip the switch, and then boom, we're like warriors. It doesn't work like that.
People should do what they need to do to protect their family. So if you're in a situation where you like need to up your warrior points 3-4 notches quickly, by all means, do it, but do it safely and do it in a smart way. But basically, guys, I think my biggest thing and the biggest takeaway I want you guys to get from this video is that we have to confront the pros and cons of the game plan that we're running as Asians in the macro, but specifically more as Chinese people. Because China, we can't, let's not lie, Andrew, not all Asians have the same philosophies. I would say there's an overarching sort of like philosophy, but there's a lot of differences within the silos underneath the umbrella. And I would say that Chinese, probably being the largest group in America, I mean, we're the biggest race in the world. It's a group that's particularly being hated right now by the Western society or global society, whatever.
Yeah.
Fairly, unfairly, neutrally, whatever. I mean, you know what I mean? I don't even want to get into it. We've got to really examine the upside and the downside of our game plan. Like, we've got to do it. I've been stressing this. You can look at this Instagram post that I made. I'll pop up the Instagram post right here. You know what? Let me just read it. I'm just going to read the Instagram post to close out because this is just... Andrew, let me just read it right now. Because you know what? I'm just like... I just got to this point. I just got to read it. Don't let the flashy high and low events distract from the fact that this has, by and large, not saying there aren't exceptions, always been the way it's been for Asians in the West. We are put in the beta position to the dominant alpha position in the majority of in real life settings, whether that's in the streets or the Fortune 500 boardroom. It's just amplified or toned down based on the larger trends of the moments. But we can change this, first with ourselves, then as a community. My whole thing is, let's use this moment to reflect on why we generally choose to run this plan, its pros and cons, which are on full display right now, then make actual changes as a community, fractured as we are internally. Clearly, a lot of Asians are not happy with the cons of the keep your head down and work through racism anything game plan. But there has to be a real plan on what to do. Real dialogue with your family and friends and people around you. Everyone is going to come up with a different answer for themselves based off capabilities and risk aversion. But I just suggest people take the next real step other than internet shock and outrage.
Listen, everybody, we have to have actual conversations about the plan that we're running. Do we still want to be poodles or doves, or do we want to be warriors, or what level do we want to be in between? And this can be on a community level or an individual level. Obviously, you can speak for yourself. You can kind of choose different levels, but you should have a plan.
Yeah, and you can't just go, oh, I'm 10 out of 10 dove, 10 out of 10 hawk, 10 out of 10 warrior, 10 out of 10 scholar. Literally, guys, that doesn't make sense. Even when you design like a car, you have to make a lot of trade-offs, you know, between weight and engine size and,
I mean,
miles per hour and just all these.
I don't want to get into it. I think that there's a lot of different issues that Asians need to use this thinking for, you know, and it can be so many aspects, like any aspect that about Asian culture being Asian in the West that, you know, a lot of people are like fed up about or like kind of upset about. We're just asking you guys to begin the process of processing it.
Yeah.
Like, you have to start looking at it analytically, because trust me, the way we're raised, and no shade to the parents, and I can't, not every parent's the same, but like the way our community is, there's not enough conversation about it.
Yeah, I would say that our community, as long as people are getting higher level degrees and making between $60,000 and $150,000 a year, all these other like flashpoint incidents, they kind of like get dismissed. It's not that people don't care about them when they pop up, but they're probably like, oh, well, that amount of slack has been built into the algorithm. Mm-hmm. what I'm saying is, like, I'm speaking to, like, basically, like, yeah, that was built in. Like, there was some, like, right, collateral damage built into the algorithm that the community runs. And it's like, yo, it's becoming too much. Like, if anything, even if you're thinking like a robot, and it's funny because, Andrew, a lot of people accuse Asians, specifically Chinese people, of being robots, right? So let's just, first of all, I don't think that's true, but let's just think robotically here. Right. The algorithm is still being thrown out of whack because the downside is no longer being mitigated. It's like too much downside, right, to justify the algorithm.
Well, dude, honestly, if we were robots, they would be calculating things and being like, okay, guys, we probably have to figure something out. One side seems to outweigh the other.
The attack levels of us being victims is soaring out of control, the balance.
I've processed the numbers, ran them through many algorithms, and I've come to the conclusion that there needs to be a different solution.
I mean, dude, we just got to make a change, man. And it's like,
I think everybody has to play their part. All hands on deck for this. Yeah. Everybody has to be in this conversation on a different level.
Yeah, and like I said, some people I think are, it's uncomfortable for them to engage in the macro, at least in this moment. Take care of your family. Call your grandma. Call your grandma's friend. If, like, you know what I mean? Like, my grandparents passed away, all of them. You know, our grandparents have passed away at this point, RIP. I saw old lady in Chinatown the other day, trying to get her walker up, like, over a curb, and the car was coming, and I was just like, all right, not that I think the car was gonna hit her, but it just was a bad situation. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you know what, I'm just gonna take 5 minutes out of my day and just, like, handle this, or, like, help out. That's a micro, because it was just something in front of me.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? So I just think that if people can help in the micro or the mid, it can contribute to the macro, or other people, like you said, more suited to contribute on a more macro level.
And, you know, to the people who say, oh, it's going to be hard for Asians to change, it's hard for Chinese people to change and adapt, I'm like, listen, look at where we're at. Like, look how far in one generation Asians can take themselves. Why can't we just use that energy and some of that thinking that we use to study and do the SATs and climb our way up the corporate ladder? Like, just use some of that thinking for having these conversations and changing this.
Sometimes we have funny videos. Sometimes we have deep videos. Sometimes you just got to say what you got to say, guys. Life is short.
What are you going to do about, how are you going to have this conversation? How are you going to take the first step to at least having this conversation to process all this and to figure out a plan?
We're going to donate to an anti-racism cause in your name. So leave the best comment about what Asian Americans should do to prevent this from constantly happening perpetually. And I will pin the best one. And you don't have to be Asian, by the way. It can be anybody. And I will pin the best one. And we're going to donate $50 to an anti-racism charity in your name.
All right, everybody. Thank you so much for watching. And until next time, we out.
Peace.